All right, we're going to pass the bags now. I'm going to invite Bill Johnson up to share with us. Woo. Yeah. Woo. A resident teacher. He's going to teach us about the value of motherhood. All right? Yeah, something like that. Resident teacher. You can hold on.
Resident teacher. I am going to. Okay. Well, it's always amazing when we start, there's like 8 people here. You get turned crazy. All right, I want to do a couple things this morning. This is Mother's Day, and I just want to say, first of all, I have a really deep appreciation in my own heart for mothers. I really didn't have a great relationship with my own mother, but I have a deep appreciation for mothers, and I'm going to share with you why quickly. If it wasn't for mothers that walked with God, I wouldn't be here today. And I have 3 in my personal walk with God. I have 3 critical, pivotal times in my walk where things could have went either way, and it was by the influence of a woman, a mother, that changed things for me. When I initially got saved, when I was in prison in Kentucky back in the 70s, and there, it was a woman that came into the prison, and I went through a counseling thing, and out of that process, I came to the Lord. And she was my mother in the Lord till she passed. She passed in her 80s, and so the relationship continued from there. And, so that was the beginning. She was the one who introduced me to Christ. And then a number of years later, I went on to pastor a church for, 12, 13 years. And after that, my home life, my family life got really out of whack, and ended up getting a divorce, number of things. I'm not going to share all that right now, but I was deeply affected by it. I felt really disappointed in God, actually really offended at God. I thought that he should have done something to prevent it. I see the whole thing completely different from today than I did at the time. At the time, that's what it appeared like, that he had betrayed me is what it felt like. And I walked away from the Lord for a season and went back out doing what I had always done, back in the drugs and so on. And if I can get this straight, I'm going to get the time straight. So after a season, there's another woman began to, I was out in the streets, really. I literally was living in the basement of a crack house. It was bad. And someone that I barely knew began to pursue me, to get help, to try to, to come do something, go to Teen Challenge and so on and so on. And so eventually my heart was won over, and I went to Teen Challenge, stayed there for 15 months. And then when I came out, her and her husband invited me into their home, and I stayed with them for 9 months. And that my life turned from that point on. And then later, after that, another situation. I really hadn't been involved in any church for a long time, and I really didn't want to. But I knew I had to get back into fellowship with the church. And I thought, I don't really want to. I thought, who am I going to call? I didn't want to hear what I expected to hear from people. And so as I thought about it, I thought, who could I call that won't take you through all that? That will just let you be where you're at and accept you and be compassionate. And another woman came to mind. And I called her and her husband, and that was a very pivotal moment in my life. And things changed from that. And I want you to know, two of those ladies are here right now. They're here. They're a part of this church. And I really feel so indebted about that, because I know I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be alive today. There's no question about it. I was on a self-destructive path, and I wouldn't have been much longer, and I would have completely self-destructed. But yeah, I just want to honor you guys. Kathy Ogborn is the one that got me to go to Teen Challenge and brought me into their home. And, you know, I call her mom to this day. I mean, I'm older than she is, but because she nurtured me as a mom, like a mom. And I really don't think I'd be alive. I don't think I'd be here today if it wasn't for her. And then Mary Bertrand, when I was, you know, knew I had to do something. And because I've known her and her husband for a long time and knew that she's very compassionate and carried a lot of mercy, I knew I'd be safe. And so I called her. And then we got back, and it was out of that relationship that with them and another couple that we began to covenant together, out of that, to pray for our children. And that's when Nate and the other guys here today too, that we prayed for. This is crazy. I didn't even think about all that when I was getting ready to speak. With their neighbors, Tim and Lisa Lowndes, we got together, we're praying for our children, and both of them came to the Lord out of that. But the point is, I mean, it's a big story, and I'm not going to tell it all, but I wouldn't be here. I was, you just don't even know. And I have a deep appreciation for mothers. There's something about a mother that is so, I can't even explain it, and I'm going to try to share a little bit about it out of the Word of God, what it does say about it. You know, we need both mothers and fathers. We do. We desperately need both. We may not realize it, but we do. And though, you know, God reveals himself as Father, but I almost hate to tell some of you this, you'll take this wrong, but he's not a male. He's not male or female. He reveals himself as God the Father, but guess where mothers and fathers came from? They came out of him. He created Adam and Eve. Do you realize in the very beginning, Adam and Eve were called Adam? It was God, Adam that named her Eve. God called them both Adam. And Adam just simply means man. And so that we need both of, God has mothering aspects to him, and that's what I want to show you. You should be glad that he does. Yeah, if you just take what the scriptures talk about, fathers can be too rough, too hard sometimes. That's why he tells fathers, be careful you don't exasperate your children by being too tough on them. You know, we need both. We need mothers who are understanding, they're compassionate, they're nurturing, and you need both of those things. We need to know both of those qualities of God. God has both of those, and we need to see them. All right, and here was the other thing I want to tell some of you that are here, maybe visiting or you're new. I've never been in a church anywhere that had as many good mothers in it that there is here. I'm amazed. I really am. I mean, good mothers. So I say that to tell you, if any of you young ladies are looking for someone, if you need some help in that area, man, they're all around you. It's amazing. I don't know how they all got in one little church. But they did. I can just point them out. It's amazing. And so there was one other thing I wanted to say about that. Yeah, they'll come back up. All right. Let's do this. Why don't you, if you got a Bible, you want to go with me, go over to Isaiah chapter 66. Oh, while you're going there, I remember what the other one is. Let me just share with you mothers a little insight. I've gained this over time, just watching moms and families and so on. I never realized this before, raising my own kids, didn't do a good job to it. And what I have now is all by the grace of God. My children, they're all okay. And Nate's obviously a part of what's going on here. And that was by the grace of God. I want to share this one little thing. I gained this over time. It's small, but it's big to me. And I see moms struggling with kids, you know. What do you do? You know, they're always this, they're always that. Listen, I got a little secret for you. Here it is. You know what the key is? You need to win the hearts of your children. Yes. Listen, when you win their hearts, you don't have to worry about all that other stuff. Trying to get them to obey, trying to get them to do this and do that. You need to learn how to get in and win their heart. When you have their hearts, you have them. Now just take, you know, if that doesn't make any sense to you, take it with you and think about it. Listen, I don't know who wrote this or who came up with it first, rules without relationship breed rebellion. Rules without relationship breed rebellion. And I'm standing here today to tell you that's true. That's what we did. I didn't know any better. And had lots and lots of rules. They broke them all the time. It didn't work. You know why? Because we weren't imparting love to them and understanding and all the other things that are needed. This came to mind while I was preparing for this. I'm going to throw it out and do whatever you want with it. Listen to this. If you're Christian, somebody told me, this was years ago, I don't even remember who it was, said, if your Christianity doesn't work at home, it doesn't work, don't export it. Let me tell you again, listen. If your Christianity doesn't work at home, then it doesn't work. Don't export it. That's some good advice. That's a good point. All right. Isaiah chapter 66. One little verse. Look in verse 13. It says, as one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you. As one whom his mother comforts, so I, God, will comfort you. Now, watch this. And if you read through the scriptures and take everything that says, one of the predominant qualities of a good mother, she's comforting. She carries comfort. How many can attest to it in your own life? When you were hurting, where did you run? When you were little, you know, you want mom. Mothers are very comforting. And that's a premier quality. And I want to show you a couple of things with this. Okay, so go over to 1 Thessalonians in chapter 2. Now, if you don't know where that's at, let's see, go. You got the Gospels, you got Acts, Romans, 1st, 2nd Corinthians. Just go back a few more books and you'll find it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. And let's go to verse 11. Now Paul in chapter 2 is talking about his apostleship. And he's talking to them about when I came to you. Didn't I do this and wasn't I like this when I was with you? And he has a very fatherly heart for them. But I want you to see something. I never really caught this myself before until I was trying to get in the scriptures for this. But look in verse 10. You are witnesses, and so is God, how devoutly and uprightly and blamelessly we behave towards you believers. Just as you know how we were, now watch this, we were exhorting and encouraging and imploring each one of you as a father would his own children, so that you'd walk in a worthy manner worthy of God who called you to his kingdom and glory. So he said, we were like a father to you, and we did those three. This is the things that we did when we were with you. Encouraged, we exhorted, and implored. But watch this. I never put this together before. But drop back before this to verse 7. Still him talking about the same situation. He said, but we proved to be gentle among you as a nursing mother. Same guy. He first talks to them about he was like a mother to them, a nurturing mother. Then he talks to them about being a father. Now watch this. Let's read that verse 7 and 8. But we proved to be gentle among you as a nursing mother tenderly cares for her own children, and having this thus a fond affection for you, we were well pleased to impart to you not only the gospel of God, but also our own lives, because you had become very dear to us. Now, so Paul was revealing both of those aspects of God to the church. That he said we were like a nurturing mother. We were very tender with you, very compassionate with you. But when you needed it the other way, then we were like a father to you, and we encouraged you and we implored you. That's amazing. The same guy, same. I never saw them two together before. So I look at that. Why did he do that? Because you need both. The church is a family, and we need both the fatherliness of God and both the mother aspects of God. Mothers have certain characteristics that are peculiar to them. All fathers should have them, but they're most predominant with moms. And what he just said here, tenderness. Don't you appreciate tenderness when you need it? So when you're in a certain place, you need that motherly tenderness, comfort, we just said. Compassion, moms are usually a bit more compassionate. Not always. These are general statements. Obviously, there's going to be all kinds of exception, but here's one else that stands out to me. And even though I didn't have a great relationship with my mom, I see over time through these ladies very, very understanding. I found that the women that played those roles in my life were very, very understanding. And boy, you need that. I don't know about you. I need that. I need to, especially when you're in trouble, you're hurting, you're going through something, you want to be understood with tenderness, not just, okay, yeah, but with compassion, understanding where you're at. Somebody who will get down in there with you, sit down with you, not telling you got to come up and come out and do this and that. There's a time for that. I understand that's why we need both. But moms, we need moms that are comforting and compassionate, will get down in there with you and sit down with you and understand what's going on in your life. And here, listen, guys, you never get too old. I mean, I know in some sense you do, but man, it's always good to have a mom or a dad. Now, both of mine are gone now, and my mother-in-law's gone. She was 84 when she passed. But her influence on my life continues to this day. So in a sense, she lives on in me. You know, I learned a lot from her. They won't give up on you. That's a big deal, you know? To have somebody who won't give up on you. Especially when you give up on yourself. But to have somebody who won't. We all need that. I don't care. You never get too old, too big, too anything that you don't need someone that can be a mother to you and someone who can be a father to you. We need that. God created us that way. Yeah, you become a mother and father, but you still need it yourself. There's, you know, I mean, just the way it is. Now, if you think you don't need it, you're fooling yourself.
Sure.
We need it. And so we need, in the church, we need mothers and fathers, spiritual mothers and fathers who can do that for people. Because, I mean, for the most part, lives are so out of sync where there's not mothers and there's not fathers involved. And the church needs to be able to help step in there and supply what's not there. Again, you never get too old for that. Age really has nothing to do with it. Does it? It doesn't have anything to do with that. If you need one, you need one. And I'm so grateful for the ones in my life, both of you ladies. I can't even express it. You know, when you read through the Word of God, if you'll read it with your heart, not just your head, you'll begin to see this exalted place that God puts women in. It may not look exalted. God so highly honors moms in women. And you can easily miss it if you're not looking. But He does. It's just amazing to me. And you know, something that stands out as I've looked back through the Word of God and with mothers and that, and God puts a lot of trust in mothers. Do you realize that?
Yes, sir.
He trusts you to bring another human being into existence. To bring them into, to birth them and then to raise, that's amazing. He trusts you. Just think about that. You know, the world has given us such an idea of what women, about women, mothers are so distorted that it's not even, it's just. And we all need our minds renewed from the Word of God about what they are, who they are. Because until I see them through God's eye, I haven't really seen them. And He's let me be able to share some of His heart about that and see through His eyes. And we need that. We need to be able to see them the way He sees them. All right, I want to do one other thing. In the Bible, there's a number of women that God really used in a great way. I have two favorites that have always been my favorites. I've got reasons for that. One of them was named Abigail. She became the wife of David after her husband died. His name was Nabal. Guess what his name means?
Fool.
Good thing he died. Well, it was because God killed him. What a shame. Because he was such a fool. And then David took her and married her. The other one is named Jael. Not Jael. Jael. And I want to talk to you about her this morning. She's always been one of my favorites. I have reasons. It may not mean anything to anybody else, but they do to me. So if you want, go over with me to Judges chapter 4. It's right kind of in the beginning of the book. After your first five books, you go, and I think then it's, you just keep moving to the right. You'll find it. Chapter 4. Now this is the judges. There was a period of time in the history of Israel, about 350 years, where God governed and ruled the nation through what the scriptures call judges. Really, judges, probably not the best term, but that's how they translated it. They were more like heroes than anything because they came in, God used them to save the people out of the places they were in and brought them back to Him. But out of this 350-year period, there was a time when there was one woman judge out of that whole period of time. Her name was Deborah. And it was during her time when she was ruling that Jael appears on the scene. So we don't want to read it all, so I'm going to just try to put it together here quickly for you so you can understand what's going on. So let's see, how can we do this? In chapter 4, verse 2, it talks about Jabin is the king of Canaan. Now understand, during this time, for about 20 years, Canaan had was severely imposing themselves on the nation of Israel, putting them under great stress, threats, and all this going on. And so Deborah is operating. She's, the Bible calls her in verse 4 a prophetess. So she's one who could hear from God, spoke on his behalf, all right? So drop down, let's see. Verse 6, she sent and she summoned somebody named Barak. Some will translate or pronounce it Barak or Barak. I think it's Barak, though. But anyway, she calls him in. Now, we don't know nothing about him. We don't know who he was. I'm assuming, I don't know this, that he's somebody in the military because of what she asked him to do. But I don't know that because it doesn't say. And here's what she says. Let's look at this, what she tells him. Verse 6, she sent and summoned Barak, the son of Abinadab, from Kadesh Naphtali, and said to him, "Behold, the Lord, the God of Israel, has commanded, go and march to Mount Tabor, and take with you 10,000 men from the sons of Naphtali and from the sons of Zebulun. And watch this, and I will draw out to you Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his mighty many troops, to the river Kishon, and I will give him into your hand." So she's prophesying to Barak that the Lord is saying that you are to take men and you're to go up to Mount Tabor, and I'll bring him out of hiding there, and you take him, and you'll win this battle. Okay, that's what's going on. Look in verse 8 though. Then Barak said to her, "If you will go with me, then I will go, but if you won't go with me, I won't." We don't know why he says that. And I'm not sure why he said it, but watch this. This was not a smart thing to do. Look in verse 9. She said, "I will surely go with you. Nevertheless," watch this, she's prophesying again, "the honor shall not be yours on the journey that you are about to take, for the Lord will sell Sisera into the hands of a woman." Then Deborah rose and went with Barak to Kadesh. And Barak called Zebulun and Naphtali together to Kadesh, and 10,000 men went up with him. Deborah also went up with him. Now listen to this. Now Heber, the Kenite, had separated himself from the Kenites, from the sons of Hobab, or Hobab, the father-in-law of Moses, and pitched his tent as far away as the oak of that big long word, which is near Kadesh. I don't know how you even pronounce that. So it looked like he's stuttering. I don't know how to say it. Then they told him Sisera that Barak, the son of Abinadab, had gone up to Mount Tabor. Sisera called together all his chariots, 900 iron chariots. All the people were with him from, see that big word? I don't know how to pronounce it. To the river Kishon. Verse 14, and Deborah said to Barak, "Arise, watch this, for this is the day in which the Lord has given Sisera into your hands. Behold, the Lord is going out before you." So Barak went down from Mount Tabor with 10,000 men following him. The Lord routed Sisera and all his chariots and all his army with the edge of the sword before Barak, and Sisera alighted from his chariot and fled on foot. Now watch, verse 16, but Barak pursued the chariots and the army as far as, and all the army of Sisera fell by the edge of the sword, not even one of them was left. So they wiped him out. Only ones that survived is Sisera. He's on the run. So what verse was that? Verse 17. Now Sisera fled away on foot to the tent of Jael. She's the wife of Heber, the Kenite. For there was peace between Jabin, the king of Hazor, or Canaan, and the house of Heber, the Kenite. They just had a truce, is the point. They probably had business dealings, but they had a truce between them, is the point. Now watch what happens. Verse 18. And Jael went out to meet Sisera, and she said to him, "Turn aside, my master. Turn aside to me. Do not be afraid." And he turned aside to her into the tent, and she covered him with the rug. I couldn't help when I'm reading it, and I stopped it for a while, and I had to laugh. You know, we used that saying about sweeping something under the rug. Well, she did. She swept this dirt under the rug. And he said to her, "Please give me a little water to drink, for I am thirsty." So she opened a bottle of milk and gave him a drink, and she covered him. Now, there's a principle here I want you to see in verse 19. We won't turn there. I'll give you the addresses, and you can look it up later. One of them is in Proverbs 25:21. The other is Romans 12:20-21. Here's what it says. If your enemy hungers, give him something to eat. And if he thirsts, give him something to drink. That's what the scriptures tell. And that's what she did. She not only did, she gave him something more than what he even asked for. She gave him milk. Now watch though. And he said to her, "Stand in the doorway of the tent, and it shall be if anyone comes and inquires of you and says, 'Is there anyone there?' Then you shall say, 'No.'" Okay. But watch what happens. But Jael, Heber's wife, took a tent peg, and she seized a hammer, and seized a hammer in her hand, and went secretly to him, and drove the peg into his temple. And it went through into the ground, for he was sound asleep and exhausted, so he died. And watch. And behold, as Barak pursued Sisera, Jael came out to meet him and said, "Come, and I'll show you the man you're looking for." And he entered with her, and behold, Sisera was lying dead with the tent peg in his temple. So God, now watch this, so God subdued on that day Jabin, the king of Canaan, before the sons of Israel. You remember what she had prophesied to him back then? "Because you delayed and you don't want to go, well, therefore, the honor will not be yours, but it'll be given to a woman." Now watch this. God turned this whole thing around through a woman. And so I want us to talk about that for just a minute. Go back to verse 21. It said, "But Jael, Eber's wife, she took a tent peg, and she seized a hammer." She took a tent peg. Understand, a tent peg is like what a foundation is to a house. So we're talking about something that's foundational and something's fundamental. But it says she seized the hammer. See that word seized? When I was meditating on that the other night, about on this verse, I got this picture in my mind. Have you ever watched those people who ride bulls in what do you call it, rodeos, whatever it is, and the guy rides the bulls, and before they let them out, they're in a stall. I mean, the bull's wanting to get loose. And you ever watch how they do their hand? They got to get that thing, the straps just right so they can stay on there but and yet be able to let go too. I'm not sure what they do, but they got something they do. And I have that picture that says she seized a hammer. She took hold of it in a way outside the norm. And then I couldn't help but think of the other time when one of David's mighty men had taken a sword and killed, I don't know how many, 300 guys. And it said his hand cleaved to the sword. They had to peel his hand off the sword. And I got this thing that in, this is what was going on with her. She grabbed, says she took a tent peg, but she seized the hammer. You only gonna get one shot at this. You know, if you don't do it right and he wakes up, it ain't gonna be good. So think about what's going on here, but she's gonna do it. She's not backing off, she's gonna do it. Now, listen to this. Most of you may not realize this. In fact, let me just go there and read it to you so you will know that it's actually in the Bible. Jeremiah chapter 23 and verse 29. Listen to what it says. "Is not my word like a fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that shatters the rocks?" The Lord said, "Is not my word like a hammer that shatters the rocks?" Listen, there's a picture. The Old Testament is meant to give you picture form of spiritual realities. And if you can view that this way, understand on one hand, she has the Word of God. On the other hand, it says she had a tent peg, foundation, fundamentals, things she's learned that she's proven out in her own life. And she seized them and she took them. And what did she do? She drove it through his head. It said it went through into the ground. You've got to be pretty strong to take it. What, I don't think it was an iron tent peg. It was most likely wood. You've got to be pretty powerful to drive a tent peg through somebody's skull and then into the ground. Here's what you may not understand, that in the time, culturally, the men didn't put up the tents. When they traveled, whatever they did, the women and the children put the tents up and took them down. She was very familiar with that hammer and with that tent peg. She'd used it many times. She knew exactly how to use it. And she always is very strong. Now, you got to understand, in the time, in the culture, when you look for a wife, you wanted one that was strong. It was all right if she looked good, but it'd be better if she's strong. Now, I may sound whatever to you, but it's true. Look, you need help. They were serious about a helpmate. They needed somebody to help do everything, right? So, but notice she had, think about that, drive it right through somebody's skull and then into the ground. Now notice this again, the Old Testament gives you pictures. Where did she drive the stake through? His head. Watch this. Over in Genesis chapter 3, when the curse is pronounced upon the serpent. Do you remember that? Let me go there and read it to you. Genesis chapter 3. Verse 15, God is speaking to the serpent. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel. So he's talking, obviously, prophetically about the Messiah, that he would, the word's bruised here, but it's actually the word for crushed. And so it's prophesying that the one coming will crush the head of the serpent. Now watch this. The head represents more than just that thing sitting on your shoulders in the scriptures. It speaks about the seat of government. It speaks about ruling authority. That's why we call them the head of companies, head of the army, head of this and head of that. And there's a picture here. She took the Word of God, the fundamental Word of God that she had proven out in her own life, and she drove it through what? His head. Now, I don't know if you've ever seen this in the Old Testament. Many times in battle, when they conquered a place and took the king, guess what they did? They cut his head off. Do you remember that David did that to Goliath, cut his head off? What's the picture saying to you? We've severed that thing. We've severed that government. We brought it to an end. We've cut it off. It happened to King Saul. They cut off his hands and his head. And that was something they did. Remember all that. It's there. There were others. But so the head, I mean, there's, what a picture that God has put there. And guess who he did it through? Here's an army coming. They're right around, but guess who did it? She drove that thing right through his head by herself. Nobody around her to protect her. But she did it. Now I want us to look at her, because this is amazing to me, and you need to see these qualities, these characteristics that obviously were present within her. Now watch this. Let me give them to you. She was in the right place at the right time by divine appointment. She didn't know. She didn't get any previous information. But God had her in the right place at the right time. She was, watch this, guys, she was available. Many times God can't use you and I because we're not available to him. We're too caught up and distracted with everything else. And we're not available to him. She was available. Guess what else she was? She was accessible. She was accessible to man and available to God. She obviously took risk. She had courage, boldness. She was fearless. She was in. How did she know to do that? Nobody sent her a text or an email telling her, hey, when he comes, do this and that. How did she know to do that? Listen, I can tell you why, the same way you should know when things come up when you're in situations. She was in touch with the throne. She knew what was going on. She had eyes to see. She could see. Listen, she was looking with the eyes of her heart. Remember, Jesus told the disciples, he said, you would say, there's still 4 months to harvest. So listen, I'm telling you, it's not. Lift up your eyes. There's a harvest right now, if you can see it. That's what he was saying. Listen, you and I, as new covenant believers, you have eyes in your heart and ears, and you need to be paying attention to what's going on around you. She was able to step into the moment. She was present to the moment. Amazing to me. Watch this. She was, now watch this. Obviously, she was prepared.
Right.
I always see she's like prepared and on standby. But she's listening. She's watching. And because you only got it. How long do you think she had there? She didn't know when he's going to wake back up. But she was so in touch with what was going on around her and prepared internally that she was able to step into that moment and turn the whole thing around for the whole nation. That's amazing. You need to watch that. She was able to navigate the affairs of daily life without becoming entangled in them. That's why she was able to be available. She had a history with God. Had to have. There's no other way. How would she know? How would she been willing to do that? She had no formal, just put this together with you, for yourself. She had no formal or special training. She didn't go take go to a conference to get ministry instruction. She had no formal special training or prior preparation or was a part of any ministry. But she had a life with God in everyday life. She didn't have to go to somewhere to do ministry. Nothing wrong with that, but just understand. Some people want to go out to do ministry. Listen, ministry can take place right where you're at. You don't have to go anywhere. Now listen to this, not only her, but Abigail and all these others, the things that they became known for, their exploits, they all took place in the midst of everyday life. Not one of them was something special where they had to go do it somewhere. It was in the midst of everyday life. They were paying attention to what was going on around them. They were in touch. They were available and willing to do whatever needed to be done. And what happened, happened without their foreknowledge, and it was unplanned for. Now think about that. They had to be in the moment, spontaneous, to be willing to move and do that. I think that's amazing to me. All right, let's see. I think that's probably all you need right now. That's probably enough. Okay, prepared, yeah. That's amazing. Now, let me just put it like this. Listen, because some people think, you know, someday I'll get in ministry or I need to get trained. I need to. Listen, if you just walk with God, if you just cultivate a life with God, listen, you won't have to go anywhere. He'll bring the opportunities to you.
That's right.
He will. I have more opportunities when I never leave the house. I don't have to go look for them. Most of the time they come to me. But just all he desires is that we're available and we're prepared to the degree we can be prepared. So I just want to encourage you ladies with that. I'm just, again, I am deeply appreciative of mothers and women in general, but mothers especially, because I see how valuable that what you are and what you do is to the rest of us. And to never think that it doesn't matter. The enemy in our society wants us to think that to be a stay-at-home mom is something down here. Actually, in the value system of the kingdom, it's way up here. The sacrifice is actually the other way. You sacrifice all the stuff to do the thing that's most valuable. And don't allow the world to change your thinking. Think you're not doing anything if you're just raising your kids.
Come on, Bill.
I mean, you're changing ages to come. Listen, what you do today is going to affect generations to come.
That's right.
Don't ever buy into that mess that, well, you'd be glad when you get down here so you can go do ministry. Listen, it's right in your lap. Take care of do what you do. Concentrate right there. Listen, I literally think about it. You're affecting generations to come, not just yours, but the ones that come after that and after that. So I just want to encourage you with that. I mean, don't take on that mindset that you're not really this or you're not really that because you're not, you're not out in the ministry and all that. But you're so, I wish I could even express how valuable and how much honor and love God has for you because of you being a mother. I wish I could have words to describe it. I don't. But he sees that so much different than the world does. And don't buy into that other stuff. Don't buy into the lies. All right, I think that's it. You want to do something?
That's it. I want to do something here. All right, we're going to close out today. Just speak and pray a blessing over the mothers that we have here.
Bill, did you still want to share that song?
No, we're looking at
you. Okay.
All right. So why don't we do this? If you're a mom, or really even if you're the teenage girls in here, future mom, mother-to-be, absolutely. Those who've fostered, those who've adopted, any scenario or any situation where you've had the opportunity to mother, we want to pray and bless you. And even minister to those who've gone through the pain that hasn't come to fruition in childbirth. We want to gather around the women in our congregation and just lovingly bless them. So women, if you wouldn't mind, stay seated. And guys, if you have a mom or a grandmother, a daughter, whoever you want to pray over at this time, I'm going to speak a blessing. And I want you guys to kind of resonate with it. So guys, if you'll stand up. And even this is probably a good opportunity too for those that are mothers who have mothered and all the kids are out of the house and you want to take that role of, hey, it's time for me to disciple other women in mothering. Please take advantage of the opportunity to go pray for one of these ladies as well, okay? If you guys can bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we bless our mothers this morning. Thank you, God, that you're going to give them patience and perspective during temper tantrums and bedtime negotiations. Thank you, God, that you will give them supernatural rest when sleep is lacking. God, thank you that you give wisdom to those who ask for it. So we ask for a double portion for every single mother who is or who will be parenting teenagers someday. God, we pray for grace for our mothers for when there is no quiet time available to get with you. Thank you, God, that just as Bill said, it's in the day-to-day busyness, the day-to-day chaos, that women can stay ready to do ministry and to raise the next generation. God, I pray for the gift of joy in the midst of picky eaters, of blowouts and permanent markers. God, that in every season of motherhood, we would have holy mothers, and that they would feel fully appreciated by their children, by their husbands, and by the families that they influence through their mother and nature. Thank you, God, for the legacy that lasts through their influence in our children's lives. And God, for those who have entered into a new season of discipling, the mothers that are mothering right now. God, we pray for peace and comfort for those who have a difficult time celebrating Mother's Day, for those that have lost mothers, those that have yearned to be a mother, and those who have lost children. God, we pray for peace and comfort. And I pray that you would give mothers a supernatural outlook of hope and significance, because they have the most important job in the world. Thank you, God, that these women will shape the next generation of forerunners, world changers, and history makers. Thank you, Jesus. We love you. We bless you. Thank you for the priority you place on the women and the mothers in Scripture so that we can prioritize them in the same way. We love you and we thank you. And we pray all these things in our Savior Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.